Welcome back. We have got as far as deriving the finite dimensional weak form for 3D linearized elasticity. What we're going to do in this segment is essentially press ahead with the formulation. And of course, you know how this proceeds. We essentially have to define basis functions, construct representations for the fields that we care about, and go ahead and compute the integrals that arise in the weak form. Okay? So, I'm going to call this segment the finite dimensional weak form and basis functions. Okay, and remember just the integral equation we are working with is the following. I'm not going to put down the whole finite dimensional weak form in all its glory, but just remind ourselves of what we are trying to accomplish here, right? We are trying to solve the following equation. Integral over omega wh I comma j sigma h ij dv equals integral over omega w h I f I dv plus this curious sum of integrals which has this form. Sorry, the W bar is not required. W H I T bar I DS. And I'm not going to state it now, but just recall that on the last integrand, we don't have a sum implied. Okay, we have this, and of course there are constitutive relations, and we've studied those in some depth. As you imagine now, we essentially have to define basis functions, right? In defining basis functions, as before, we will do this by constructing a partition of our domain, right? We partition our domain as follows. Basis, our domain of interest, which is really the body that we want to solve a linearized elasticity problem over. That's our domain omega. Actually, let me leave that outside of the body because we'll confuse it with other things. Okay, that's omega. We have the usual decomposition of the boundary subsets. And right, the way we do the decomposition is essentially the way we did it in the case of the 3D elliptic problem with the scalar variables, right? The kinds of elements we considered there are admissible here as well, okay? And to fix ideas, let's look at hexahedra. Okay, so that is an element omega e, and the partition of the domain is, as always, given to us as follows: the union over e of all these open element subdomains. Closed gives us a closure of the body. Okay, as always, we have omega e one. Intersection omega E2 is the empty set, right? They're disjoint. Okay, we have this. And we're going to go ahead and construct our basis functions using this sort of decomposition. Equivalently, now that we've talked about it, we could also have had a tetrahedral, a decomposition into tetrahedra. Okay? All right. The way we are going to go ahead and construct our basis functions is, as we know very well, is to consider nodes on the element. And again, just to fix ideas, as I'm drawing things out here, I'm going to consider trilinear hexahedra. So those are our nodes. We only have nodes at the vertices. Okay, and we know that. Okay, we know that detail. Right. So now let me suppose that this is element omega e. Right. This is the element that we started out with, which has now been essentially expanded out here. Okay. That's element omega e, and that is our node a equals 1 for the element. Right. I'm following here the local numbering of nodes. Okay. That's 2, 3, 4, and so on. We are quite expert at this by now. All right, and we are going to construct our basis functions from these nodes. The way we'll do this is to essentially define these basis functions on the nodes, and we are going to write the basis functions as before, as NA. Okay, our basis functions. This is our basis function at node A. Okay, let me say here local node A. Now, something you may have noticed is over the past minute or two, as I've introduced the nodes and the numbering, I have not been calling them, I've not yet started calling them degrees of freedom. Okay, whereas earlier I was using the term, I was using A more often for the in the context of degrees of freedom. But here I'm being very careful to call them nodes. And here's why. Okay, the reason is the following. We're going to construct a representation for our trial solution, right? And remember, our trial solution here is the displacement field. That's component I over element E, right? Now, we are going to use a representation where the basis functions will be exactly the same basis functions that we are so familiar with, right? If we are doing trilinears, we know what these are, right? They're the same basis functions. However, we, and the sum, of course, is over A going from 1 to number of nodes in the element, okay? However, each one of these basis functions is multiplied by a degree of freedom vector, okay? What this means is that for component UHI, I have D A I, E. Okay, and we need to recall here that I runs over 1 to number of spatial dimensions. Okay, so this is a little different because now, if you think about it, how many degrees of freedom does this element have? Okay. So the number of degrees of freedom in omega e, right, or on omega e, right, is, what is it? Is it just the number of nodes as it was in the previous problems we were doing? No, correct. So it is actually, in the general case, it's number of nodes in the element times number of spatial dimensions. Okay? Whereas earlier, the number of nodes on the element was the same as the number of degrees of freedom in the element. Things are a little different now. Okay? So what we have here is another way to write this is the following. We use direct notation, right? So now that is the displacement field over element E. And this is sum over A, NA, D, A, E, as before, except that that DAE, whereas it was a scalar for our problems of scalar variables, is now a vector, right? For our problem of vector variables. So, and what we have here is UHE and DAE both belong to R3, right? The three-dimensional vectors. Okay, so sorry for seeming to flog a dead horse, but what we have here are vector degrees of freedom at each node. Okay? And this is a particular approach that we take for this problem. It is not necessarily universal. Okay? So we have here a representation for a vector field, and what we're seeing is that the basis function here is scalar, just as we've been doing all along. The degrees of freedom here carry the vector information. Right? And this is common for the kinds of problems we're doing, definitely for elasticity of any kind, mechanics of any kind. It is not the same, for instance, however, in the case of the problem of electromagnetics. Okay? It's common in that case to construct finite element formulations where the basis functions are vectors and the degrees of freedom are scalars. Okay, it's just a difference. It's a difference to do with the requirements of each problem and so on, the mathematical requirements. All right, so that's something to note here. And then of course it's the same thing for the weighting function. We have WHIE equals sum over A N A C A IE, using coordinate notation, right? Where we know that I equals 1 to number of spatial dimensions, right? And using direct notation, that would be WHE equals sum over A NA C A, E. Okay? As we noted above, W, H, E, and C, A, E are 3D vectors, vectors in R3. Okay. The next thing we need to do, if we are happy with this, is to just remind ourselves of what the basis functions are. And these are constructed in exactly the same way that we know. All right? So what we are saying here is that, as before, if we have an arbitrary hexahedral element, okay, that's omega E, we construct it as always, really, from a bi-unit domain . Right, and everything proceeds just as before. Nothing new here. Okay, so in this setting, we would have, in this domain, again, we would have A equals 1, 2, 3, 4 would be in the back, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right, and this is a bi-unit domain, so this point is, as always, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, right, and so on. That point, number 7, would be 1, 1, 1, and so on, right? We know this very well now. Okay? This is how we construct our basis functions, having defined these coordinates, c1, c2, c3. What we say is that, as always, in a c1, c2, C3 will be constructed from, these one-dimensional Lagrange polynomials, right? Na tilde, and I forget what I call them. Let me suppose I call them A bar C1 N tilde B bar C2 N tilde C bar C3. I may have used different notation for the indices A bar, B bar, C bar before, but I think by now we understand this very well, right? Each of these, as we recall, is a 1D Lagrange polynomial. Okay, and we know exactly how to construct these in the case of trilinears, triquadratics, and so on. Okay, and since we are so good at this now, I don't need to belabor the point, so I'm going to tell you right away that, as always, we also use the same sort of basis functions to interpolate the geometry, right? That part, of course, continues exactly the same, because even when we were solving the linear elliptic problem in 3D with scalar variables, the geometry still was fully 3D, and the geometry was indeed defined by position vectors and so on, right? So that bit is exactly the same. Okay, so we have x e as a function of the c vector. All right, that's exactly the same map that we had before. Okay,